our series on CSO leaders.
Thank you, Sudhir.
It's actually a real pleasure to have you with us today.
I am looking forward to this conversation.
Thank you. So, Dr. Tandon, you are an electronics engineer from IIT Kanpur and a postgraduate from IIM Calcutta. And you also picked up a PhD from Cleveland in USA. So, what motivated or inspired you to get into the development sector and very early in your life?
I think the first part of it has to be that in the kind of family you grow up in, the kind of values you get. I grew up, I was born and grew up in Kanpur. My family were Lucknow, Allahabad, Itawa belt. My mother's side was four generations of teachers from primary to, and my mother herself was retired as principal of a degree college. So there was a lot of excitement about education, and there were no distinction between boys and girls. My mother was the first BA, woman BA of Kanpur. My maternal grandfather was the first non-British principal of Christchurch College, Kanpur. So there was all that. And of course, freedom movement and all. I was, of course, born after that.
After, right.
So there was a lot of, I think, values in the family and in the neighborhood make a difference. When I went to IIM, I was interested in learning more about social change. So I ended up doing more courses in social and organizational change. There were some very interesting faculty members at that time. And even though I was the gold medalist topper, I wasn't keen to join a company.
You didn't go for placement?
I never went for an interview.
Okay.
Till one day the professor in charge of placement called me and he said, "What's wrong? These companies have come. They don't, why are you not attending this?" So I said, "Sir, I'm not interested in a corporate job."
What was the PhD about? What was
department was Department of Organizational Science in a School of Management. So they said, "What is your research topic?" Went to the library and thought about it, and this, that, and the other. There was hardly any news coming because of emergency and all.
Mm-hmm.
And universities didn't have much literature. There were some old DPWs lying somewhere. And I, for totally inexplicable reasons till date, I wrote two pages on rural development. And my sort of theoretical argument was that rural society is an integral part of countries like India. Rural development is important for countries' development, blah, blah, blah. There are some reports that despite government programs, lives of rural people is not improving or something like that. And I'll go and study this.
Mm-hmm.
And I arrived in Delhi at National Labour Institute. After a few weeks of that, I bumped into the good old man, late Dr. Mohan Sinha Mehta, whom we call Bhai Saab, the founder of Seva Mandir.
Right.
In Udaipur. And he must have met me in some meeting or something. And he said, "What are you doing here?" And I told him my rural development. He said, "There is no village in Delhi. What are you doing? Come to Udaipur." So I took train, went to Udaipur. And I had a shower and all that, went to his room. And he said, "What are you doing here?" I said, "You called me." He said, "This is Udaipur, there's no rural here. You go to Kherwada."
Mm-hmm.
And he must have phoned, they had an office in Kherwada block. And that fellow there, he said, "What are you doing here?" I said, "I've come for rural." He said, "No, Kherwada, this is block headquarters, there's no rural here. You sit on my motorcycle, we'll go to Bawalwada." And we reached Bawalwada in the night. In 24 hours and in about 4 weeks from US to Bawalwada, when I reached there and spent a year working with them, I realized that I must have been the most formally educated person
mm-hmm.
in 500 kilometer radius of Bawalwada at that time. But I didn't know how to lead my life there. I was incompetent.
Right.
And my education had given me a sense of arrogance, by which I implied that illiterate people are stupid, ignorant. And to my great horror and shock, they knew a hell of a lot more. Not only about agriculture and water harvesting and, you know, looking after the cattle, but also about human relations. And I used to hang around in Chaupals and listen to Chaupal conversation. You know. So I used to compare that with the group dynamics that I studied in management school. I said, my God, this is excellent group dynamics going on here. Who taught them? So my lesson number one from that was that life, living, creates knowledge, and these people are knowledgeable. And if we do not value that knowledge, we will not be able to work with them. So I had to unlearn a bit and learn some. Unlearning was obviously more painful. The second thing, because I was working there, at that time there were two main rural development programs. One was Farmers Functional Literacy Program, which combined literacy with some farming techniques, and another which was called Lab to Land. And Lab to Land, innovation were being made in agriculture labs and, you know, brought to the land. And these were all indigenous tribal people, so, you know, I used to work with them. I realized that there was considerable disconnect between the design of the program and the requirements locally. The design was universal, and requirement in Bawalwada was very different from requirement in another part of Kherwada block in the same district. So, and these guys, these young people, you know, smart they were, but they were mortally afraid to talk about it. So I got them basically organized. I used to call them workshops or camps or whatever. And my organization was very simple. I would get information about the program, and I'd say, are you receiving this? They would say, no. Would you like to receive? Would you like this, that, and the other? They would say, yes. Then say, okay, how do we plan to get it now?
This is all part of your PhD.
It was pretending to be part of the PhD. Now, the whole story I told only after they gave me the PhD, but it was part of the process of learning. So I hung around one or two more years doing this, that, and the other. But Priya's foundation was laid in 1980-81.
Okay.
And that's what happened.
And what were the initial challenges? I understand that your initial way of research was initially, a lot of people said it was unscientific.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, of course.
And you were driving some political agenda, some people said. So what was that about? How did you...
Well, you know, first thing was that there were three themes on which we worked in the first 7-8 years in the 80s. First theme was land alienation. You know, industrialization, mining, dams, and there were no studies available. And the second was occupational health, particularly of women workers in or agricultural labor, women BD workers, and, you know, those kinds of things. And occupational health became a topic because of my links to trade union. Right. Workers. And the third was women's livelihood.
Okay.
Women's literacy and livelihood, I would put it this way. So we started applying this methodology, and when we would produce the sort of a document which we will take to others, like government officials or others, these questions would be asked. So when Priya started, I started working with other organizations with a view to help them strengthen their capacity.
Okay.
And both human and organizational capacity. And my logic was that, so in fact in 84 we did a first program on financial management. And now because of my management education and some friends, we wrote a manual on bookkeeping and all that. How to work with community began participatory learning training began. How to document your experience. In the 80s, Priya must have helped tons of organizations to produce their first annual report. So I faced two kinds of reactions immediately. One reaction was several people who were established in the voluntary sector at that time, mostly of the Gandhian persuasion, and some who came from this Chhatra Yuva Sangharsh Mani kind of movements, post JP movements, post Janata Party movements. Some of them said, oh, this is some management upstart who has come, who is telling us how to organize our work and, you know, how to keep accounts and that we should document our work. What is the need for all this? To the extent that, and there was an element of Western education, management, like management, somehow IIM and US combination created a smell which was not liked. To the extent that Prakash Karat wrote an article in the CPM in naming me as one of the epitomes of Western infiltration in development sector. So this was one reaction. On the other hand, for a lot of grassroots organizations, there was a very positive reaction. And I used to say to them that, look, you guys are so highly committed. You know, I can't find anywhere such commitment. But commitment needs to be combined with competence. If you go in the morning to make a field visit, you should start the day thinking what you will achieve today, what will you do? Basic things I began to ask. Now, a lot of people made a lot of sense, and that's how participatory methodology, which they were using, received, you can say, certain kind of recognition or visibility. And the mode of knowledge production and how they were using that knowledge to bring about attitudinal change or change in the delivery of services.
How is it different from the, if I may say, the regular way people were researching? How, why was it creating so much of dissonance in the system where people thought that this was not a scientific way? What was the concern?
I think the main concern was that, continues to be, that unless you are certified, you cannot produce knowledge. This concern is not new. This is the Brahmanical culture concern. Brahmins were certified by God to read and write in Sanskrit, and therefore they were the only knowledge producers and knowledge communicators. And all societies have had that. So here in the Western paradigm, which we adopted in our education system, we looked at certification. Unless you have MPhil, you have a PhD, you are not qualified. Even today, if you look at the UGC norms and who can be a teacher in a university, the best musician of India cannot be a teacher because she doesn't have PhD. The fellow who has PhD in music may not be a musician. So we don't have practitioners as professors in our country. So the second problem was that knowledge for change. Our argument has been that knowledge is never neutral. You either support the status quo or it is used for change. And many a times, studies done by governments, studies done by research institutes with funding from the government or whatever, may be used to propose a point of view which is not necessarily what people want. So when you juxtapose that, so our point is that there are multiple forms and sites of knowledge. When they interact, you produce a positive synthesis. So a civil engineer has a body of knowledge, but when he applies that civil engineering knowledge to drainage in Ambikapur, mm-hmm. in Sarguja, then he also learns a great deal, right. And he will find that local people also use some knowledge, because if they had no drainage, they would have been wiped out by now. Socio-economic development in a country like India is a very complex challenge, even today. It requires the best of competencies, the best. It is unfortunately not getting the best, because the best and the brightest don't consider this. So there is a requirement at every level. The difficulty is, I am finding increasingly, that 35 years ago I used to tell them, you have commitment, you need competence. Now we have a lot of competence, but shady commitment.
Why is
shady
that?
In the sense that job has become prima donna as opposed to making a difference, making an impact. And a lot of people, including these young people who work, come and work in Priya, I always tell them that in the early stage of your career, you must go and work locally for a year or two to understand reality from that point of view. Once you understand it, then you can bring your expertise to bear. Otherwise, it will remain imposition and it won't work. So, the kind of expertise that socio-economic development requires, unfortunately, in our government system and public system, doors have been shut for a variety of reasons. You know, in other countries, people like you and I could easily move from being in a civil society organization to the government, to an academic institution and come back. But that horizontal lateral entry systems don't exist. If you haven't joined government by the age 29, you are done.
So you're essentially saying that, that professional expertise is something that is definitely required, but the system needs to gear up to be able to attract and retain more of...
Attract, retain, utilize them.
Utilize, okay.
Utilize them. I mean, you see these Pradhan Mantri's rural fellows or whatever we started 5-6 years ago. Young professionals have been hired, 70,000 rupees or whatever they were giving them a month, placed with the district collector. But what are they doing? They're taking minutes of the meeting. Why would you need an IIM graduate to take minutes of the meeting? Or make a PPT for the collector who is going to present in some conference. They get frustrated and they leave. So, if you have a management expertise, apply your management expertise to improve the system of management of the district collector's office. That will be a valuable contribution. If you have an engineering expertise, apply it to the design of water system or whatever. So, this is the problem. Expertise, recruitment is one thing, but deployment and utilization is very important. And that's why people lose interest.
Thank you, Dr. Tandon. Thanks for sharing your thoughts. I think you've given us a lot to think about and see where we want to take the development sector.